short. I just want to quickly tell you kind of why I'm here. I'm Sergeant Ken Sanger of the Montgomery County Police. I supervise actually two units, but the hat I'm wearing tonight is a supervisor for the Child Exploitation Unit. We're the primary unit for Montgomery County for an internet-facilitated child exploitation case. Okay, so it can be actual physical contact when the internet was the main thing used to introduce, or it could be the child pornography stuff and the images and videos that may go across the internet. When I first started 5 years ago at this unit, I was probably very much like you. I didn't know a whole lot. I had done a temporary assignment, which was very eye-opening. And then, of course, over 5 years, your mind is just blown all the time by what you see and what's going on the internet. So a couple years ago, I started this push. It was a little slow at first of trying to get into PTAs and other groups to talk to the parents. The state's attorney's office is the group that's invited to come in and speak to our students. Typically, and you're more than welcome to reach out to their community group too at the state's attorney's office and arrange a time. And they like to do it on like a 3 or 4 year cycle, so you know they kind of hit the kids one time, I think, like in high school or middle school or what have you. So I talked to the parents. I understand time is short, so I'm going to kind of go very quickly on just the bigger important items, but I want to show this news clip. It's a Montgomery County case, and it's kind of a Reader's Digest or a Cliff Note version of why I'm here. There's a lot of information in this 2-minute, 13-second segment. So if you permit me to hit play.
It's a Baltimore County man accused of having sex with an underage girl, and police are concerned there could be more victims. WJZ's live Rick Ritter has more on the case and the growing concerns about a popular app that has been in the headlines recently. Rick?
Denise, police arrested an Essex man they say was soliciting girls on Craigslist and Kik. The popular app has been making headlines all over, but for all the wrong reasons. Take a good look at 31-year-old Roy Evans Jr., a Baltimore County man investigators say was engaged in sexual acts with a 14-year-old girl for months. This after the two connected on a popular kids app known as Kik, which has been at the center of several recent cases.
It's very scary. You don't know what these children are doing.
In February, a teacher's aide in Prince George's County was charged with child pornography and sending nude photos to kids through the same app.
A relative of one of the victims discovered a photograph on the child's phone.
Investigators also believe Kik was used in the gruesome death of Nicole Lovell. A 13-year-old used the app to communicate with her accused killer, a Virginia Tech student and Howard County native, before she was murdered.
They're animals, you know, just on the prowl for their next
pickup.
And in 2014, police say Kik led a 12-year-old girl in Perry Hall to the man who kidnapped and sexually assaulted her. Law enforcement says predators are typically targeting apps on their phone like Kik, where they can send messages and pictures but still remain anonymous.
It can absolutely happen to anyone, and it's happening all over the state.
LaDonna Morgan with the Baltimore Child Abuse Center says parents need to step up.
Ultimately, I feel like it's the adult's responsibility to protect kids.
Adding they must be more vigilant before it's too late.
You should monitor all of your child's online activity. You should know who their friends are.
Evans Jr. was arrested in Montgomery County. Now, the scary part is that investigators believe there could be more victims, specifically in the Baltimore area. Reporting live tonight, Rick Ritter, WJZ Eyewitness News.
All right, thank you very much, Rick. Evans was released from jail after posting a $150,000 bond. He faces 3 counts of third-degree sex offense.
All right, you'll permit me just to set up a slideshow real quick. I want to go over this video, though, just for a second. There's a lot of information in there. We don't know what our kids are doing. Did you hear that, right? And let me tell you, most parents have no idea. The predators are on the animals on the prowl, right? They're animals on the prowl. Kik, Kik, Kik. Kept hearing Kik. And the last thing is, it can happen to anyone. Absolutely. So a lot of information in that. By the way, real quick, just. I am being recorded, so I'm going to change what I normally say. Evans Jr. was arrested in Montgomery County. He placed an ad on Craigslist looking for young models. That should be a red flag, right? A 14-year-old Montgomery County girl answered that ad. They ended up having sex a bunch of times in Montgomery County and making videos, and she's sending pictures and all the nasty stuff. We arrested him. We charged him. initially with 3 counts of third-degree sex offense just to get him arrested in jail while we tried to figure out the child porn aspect of it all. That takes time. Let me tell you, he was looking at 0 to 2 years of jail time with a 90% chance of just 2 years, of 0 years in jail and 5 years of probation. Right? Ridiculous. Okay. So we took that case federal, and he's looking at 25 to 30 years. So your county, I think I'm comfortable saying this on tape, doesn't treat sex offenders like we would hope. All right, so Internet Crimes Against Children Task Force, that's who, that's also the hat I'm wearing. Montgomery County is an affiliate of the ICAC Task Force. Maryland State Police is our, for lack of a better term, parent task force agency. There's 61 task forces is what they call them. Basically 61 parent agencies across the country. Some states have two, like you can imagine Texas, I think Florida and other places have a couple ICAC task forces. If you think about when the internet was new, you know, law enforcement is having to, you know, basically venture into new territory with doing these types of investigations. And if we could have a victim here in Montgomery County, we could have a bad guy in California or vice versa. You know, how do we reach out and talk to each other and explain what we need and all that good stuff? They created this task force in 1998. Imagine 1998, AOL was the big dog. Netscape was your internet browser. I mean, so the internet was still kind of, you know, what we call the internet was really the World Wide Web. It was still kind of brand new. But now we all go through the same training. We all have conferences where we meet up with each other, network, and I can call up anybody nationwide, even in Canada, even in Europe and Australia. And we all speak the same language. I've worked with Australian authorities, I've worked with Swiss authorities, I've worked with Canadian authorities, and I've worked with many states. So it's a pretty neat task force that we have now. Hey, that's just supposed, that's an over-the-top visualization of what your cell phone can do, right? So when I talk internet, I'm primarily talking your mobile devices, primarily the cell phone, tablets you can throw in there. That's a little more reasonable, but it's to show you how powerful the cell phone is, and we really do underestimate it as parents.
And if they just have an iPad or some other device without the phone, is that change things?
It makes it just slightly less mobile, but no, they get hooked up to a Wi-Fi. It's no different than hooking up to a cell tower. Yeah, so your iPod touches, your tablets and all that, it's equal. The cell phone is just the most mobile because it reaches out to a cell, but no, it doesn't limit. All right, so these are the apps. I'm going to take the W out of my next presentation. These are the apps that either are the most concerning or represent the most concerning. Kik, if you ever see that logo, take it off your kid's phone. Don't let them have it. If you take one thing away from this talk, is Kik is bad. The little ghost, Snapchat, probably all of you recognize that. It's starting to go a little more mainstream. I'll tell you what to look for, though, with Snapchat still. There's not over-the-top concerns anymore like there was just a couple years ago. Instagram, all the kids are on it. I'll explain what to look for in that real quick. Grindr, that represents hookup apps. Think your Tenders, your Grindrs. People don't know what Tender or hookup apps are. I can explain it better. Omegle, what does it say under Omegle? Talk to strangers, right? Red flag. Okay, we'll go over Omegle real quick. Meet Me, I'm going to blast through Meet Me. Basically, it's just a poor man's Facebook. There's no need for kids to be on it. The little blue target sign is Scout. That's another hookup app. A lot more kids are using that than like your Grindrs and Tenders. Whisper, I'm going to skip over that because there was a concern years ago that Whisper could be the next big thing, and it just hasn't materialized, and I'm going to take it out of my presentation. So we're going to skip over Whisper. Anybody know what the bottom one with the squiggly is?
Musical.ly.
Okay. That is a concern, and I'll get to it in a minute, but it also represents all the live feeding apps like live.com, Facebook Live, you know, Instagram can go live, you know, there's big concern with that. If I have a couple minutes at the end, there's a great news story I can show you that brings that home. But let's talk about Kik. If we do one thing tonight, is Kik is bad, okay? Canadian company, why is that important to me? Anybody want to venture a guess? Out of my jurisdiction. I can't serve a search warrant on Kik, right? So, briefly, are people familiar with WhatsApp?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody not familiar with WhatsApp? Okay. You can text, you can call, you can send video, you can pictures and stuff. Kik's no different. Okay. As a matter of fact, a couple years ago at the same conference where they were concerned about Whisper, they were concerned about WhatsApp. It's going to be the next thing for all the predators, right? They were right on the concept, wrong on the actual app. Okay. All the kids went to Kik, so all the bad guys go to Kik. Kik has 300 million users as of October, probably 310 now. It's huge and getting bigger. By way of comparison, Facebook's about 1.5 billion. So, but still, Kik is big. What Kik works like Facebook, everybody has Facebook, I think. So you understand that you create an account, it's very portable, you can delete it from your phone, the actual app, but then reinstall it on another phone, and boom, you can pick up where you left off, right? So it's not like texting that's married to a phone number, and if you lose that phone number, you've got to reestablish networks and connections on it, you know. So Kik's the same thing. It's very portable. It's an app, it's a communication app, right? You create an account. Kik doesn't verify who you are. They don't really care who you are. All these apps, you need to be 13, but you can lie, right? So you can say, my name is Joe Schmo. There's easy ways to mask, you know, who you are and where you are when you create an account. Kind of be anonymous. Matter of fact, in just 2 minutes, I can sit there and make the computer think I'm in the Netherlands or Australia or China or what have you. So these are just below here, just some news articles. But I think, unfortunately, all of us see these news articles more and more every day. Let me continue with Kik. Okay, that's a very big population, 300 million. Puts it between the USA and Indonesia. One in three teens in the US are on Kik, okay? The male-female breakdown really doesn't mean anything. I just threw it in there. 44% are between 13 and 19. I really would like the numbers between 12, even though 12-year-olds aren't supposed to be on Kik, and 15, okay? Because that's, believe it or not, the target victim for the bad guys, 12 to 15. But this is what Kik gives out, 13 to 19. So that's close, right? So 132 million. Between Russia and Mexico, just imagine this, as I tell parents. If Mexico had nothing but 13 to 19-year-olds, don't you think all the perverts would go to vacation to Mexico? I do, right? They had nothing but 13 to 19-year-olds. Mexico's a big country, though. Where do you go? Cabo, Cancun, Mexico City, you know? But no, all they have to do is go right here, okay? All 132 million are right here, all on Kik. That's why the bad guys are on Kik, okay? Kik itself is not a bad app. It is what it is. It's WhatsApp with a different name. Okay? The company's not an evil company. The company didn't set out to invite all the predators to them. Okay, that's so they don't sue me. But I'm telling you, that's where all the predators are. They will meet your kids in various locations, formats, gaming. You know, how many play the PS4, Xbox, Minecraft, you know, depending on their age, where they can get online and play against and meet strangers and talk to them, right? Whether it's texting, kind of that kind of talking, or actually talking, right? The bad guys go to the gaming apps too, right? Particularly the bad guys that are interested in boys, because more boys are on those games than girls. And they'll engage in a dialogue. They'll do the grooming thing. They'll throw out, you know, statements to see how the kid reacts. And if the kid keeps a dialogue up, they'll move them over to Kik so they can find them again, and they'll continue that dialogue with that, with our children, okay? They meet on Skype randomly, or Omegle randomly, or anywhere randomly. The bad guy wants to move you over to Kik. You saw from the news story, the PG County teacher's aide, right? You moved them over to Kik, the elementary school kids. And elementary school kids create Kik accounts. Our guy, Roy Evans, Kik. I'm over to Kik. So it's where they all go. Either they meet you there, or they bring you there and continue the dialogue so they can find you and talk to you again, okay? And it's pretty much enough. You know, unless you're stupid and you actually give them your real name and your real email when you sign up. So that's why Kik's bad. That's where the bad guys are. I guarantee with 100% certainty that if you have a Kik account long enough, you're going to receive what I call spam pornography. It just feeders like, hey, here's naked people, you know, and how do you react? Do you respond to it? You know, what, 13-year-old boy say, send me more, right? Maybe. So think about that. They're going to get that kind of stuff too. These are just some headlines from not long ago, but you know, they say it's the bane of law enforcement. I'll tell you, it's the bane of the community. It's not my bane. Snapchat, real quick, okay? Used to be for taking your naked picture and poof, it goes disappear, right? Anybody familiar with that? Quickly, like within days, people figured out, hey, I can screenshot it and save the picture. And so it kind of lost its ability to go poof, right? So Snapchat has now since gone, for lack of a better term, mainstream. You see it advertised at, I saw it at Washington Nationals game, I think they have a Snapchat page. The thing to look out for as parents is, I wonder if I were to be able to talk longer, I would keep repeating monitor, 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 monitor for the next hour and a half, right? So So as you monitor Snapchat, you got to be on it because they do these storylines now. People familiar with the storylines?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Even those go poof at some point, right? And when I say poof, literally it's off the Snapchat servers. I can't search for it and I can't get it, whatever. You want to understand how your kids are feeling. And research has shown kids are putting some of their innermost feelings on these storylines, right? And if you're not monitoring, you know, the kid says, I want to kill myself. We want to know that, right? So more and more they're putting that kind of stuff out on these storylines. So I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying if your child has Snapchat, you gotta be on it to monitor it if you're gonna be, as I recommend, a parent that monitors. Just get right on it. Instagram. All right, this was good intentions, but don't try to read that. I mean, I guess. I don't think it's gonna happen here. In public school, we see, so never say never, right? Pages called THOT, T-H-O-T. Anybody familiar with that acronym? T-H-O-T, THOT. Okay, it stands for that ho over there. Kids will make, boys will make, a THOT page, a such and such school THOT page on Instagram, where they will ask girls to send topless pictures, full nude pictures, whatever, to the boy, and then he'll create a page, and he'll throw them up on Instagram, okay? And then he'll tell as much many people in the school, hey, go to this THOT page. Instagram doesn't want nudity. They certainly don't want underage nude girls. They will take it down. It's a matter of do they take it down in hours or days, okay? But it's out there, right? Anybody can grab those pictures now, anybody, and spread those pictures around. And maybe the worst part is the girls are graded, you know, like, hey, the best, the worst. Imagine you coming in last place after you're so embarrassed. These are how girls are killing themselves over stuff like this, okay? So what I tell parents was things like Instagram, which is the first and only social media my child has. So I think it's one of the safer, better ones to have if your child's gonna have social media, but you gotta monitor it. And you gotta tell our children our expectations. Don't ask for the picture, don't send the picture, don't rate the picture, don't participate in oohing and aahing over the picture. You get what I'm saying? So we have to tell them our expectations ahead of time. And Instagram is the place where kids are most likely to kind of, I hate to say it, have my kids, but inappropriately, right? The other thing with Instagram is it's also a medium for cyberbullying. If I have time, I'll go over a list of different ways you can cyberbully, and you'll see most of them are not criminal. One big thing on Instagram is exclusion. I mean, how many have teenage kids that get upset when they're not tagged, you know? Okay, so imagine a group photo of 10 kids and 9 are tagged and one's excluded because the one who took the picture doesn't like the one. You know, it has a huge effect on these kids sometimes. It's crazy. You and I don't understand it. I still don't get it. I mean, who cares? The kids rip and it interrupts school, it interrupts relationships, and it interrupts sleep patterns. I mean, so be cognizant of that, of, you know, how kids are treating other kids on Instagram. With all social media, while it's in my head, for lack of a better term, I'm a Facebook guy. So there's friends lists, you know, our friends list, right? So if your child's on any of these apps, know who their friends are. Make sure they know who they're accepting. You want to go in. You want to lock down all the security measures possible. By default, it's as open as can be. You know, when you create a Facebook page, the whole world can see it. So you go in and click, 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 and lock it down. Also be aware Facebook's notorious for this. I gotta believe they all do it. They update their security things, and sometimes you think you're locked down and you no longer are. You gotta go in and keep, so every 6 months go in and make sure, you know, like Facebook has a thing. How does the world see me? You can actually click on that and see how the world would see you. You know, hopefully it's just your profile and your cover art, you know, and that's it, right? But every once in a blue moon, Facebook will open it up. It's like, whoa, how did that get on there? Because Facebook released it, and you gotta go lock it down some more. So be cognizant of that, but lock it all down. Know who their friends are, right? So I go through with my son, like, who's this, who's this, who's this? Because it's not gonna say their name. It's gonna have some handle or something, you know, who's this? And he's gonna tell me, this is so-and-so, this is so-and-so, this is so-and-so. Twice I've caught him with people he doesn't know. Well, they ask, I'm like, dude, you don't know, right? So kick him out. The only exception, really, again, it's up to you, you're the parents, but our celebrities. Sometimes when you want to follow a celebrity, they want to follow you back. It's a whole numbers game with them. And, you know, you can, and it's, how do you know it's the real celebrity? Well, if they have, you know, 10,000, 100,000, a million followers, the chances are they're a celebrity, right?
How often do you do that with your child? How often do you go through, you know?
Not often enough. I probably do it about every 3 or 4 months, right? So let me tell you, even for me, you get kind of, like most humans, in a rut, right? You kind of like, you start off vigorous and, you know, every week you're going in and going through it, right? And then it's kind of like that. We do check his phone. I'm going to get to like some of the rules right at the end. But we do check his phone, like texts and stuff like that, probably every other day. I mean, and I'll explain when we do it and how we do it right at the end. So we still do things like that often, okay? But checking the friends list, yeah, probably every 3 or 4 months. For me, I mean, whatever works for you, right?
So you'll explain when you say monitor, specifically what that includes. You say monitor there.
Monitor like a phone, all texts, all apps. So like he actually does text, you know, old-fashioned text. You go in and you pull it open and you read it. Okay.
So you're just sitting on the phone, scrolling.
Yeah, we're just reading their conversations. Absolutely.
With your child or without?
Either or. Most of the time it's without.
If they let you.
So, no, see, that's wrong. It's not if they let you. They don't have a choice. Are you paying the bill? Right?
Right.
Yeah, you don't have. They don't have a choice.
Do you find, I find with my kids that I used to do that, but now they use Snapchat more to just message with friends,
yep.
And then you can't check.
Right. Yeah. It does go poof, but if you can, you know, as soon as I get home from school, I give me the phone, you know, something randomly, just do that. Nobody's perfect. You can't be perfect, right? A way to avoid that is say you can only ever Snapchat. You're not letting me read it. Right.
We had this evening here for 8th grade parents, right? Recently, I recall, and there were questions about how do we as parents monitor our children when it comes to, you know, their apps. And I think every single person felt in our evening, not often enough. And it's just because we're all so busy. But I think that what I felt coming out of that evening is just more often, each one of us will figure out what works for us. But more often, to be mindful of it and to realize that they're kids and they can make stupid mistakes pretty easily. And just to increase, however much it is, again, each person will try to figure it out. But to increase it, to do it more often with the child and sometimes without the child, just to do our best to be involved and aware of what's going on.
Yes, ma'am.
Can I just make one more comment, continuing on with what she said? I also find that Snapchat is a very popular tool for the kids to communicate because it does go poof. So it is much harder to monitor and keep track of something like that. So what's the right step there? I mean, sure, you can ask your kid, what are you communicating on Snapchat, but they'll think of the last 2 Snapchat chats and not what's been going on throughout the day. You can't monitor that. What do you do?
There is something for you to look into. Okay, for one, my kid won't have Snapchat. So that's the big, best option. Okay? There's something called TeenSafe. It's a paid program. You'll have to do the research because we used it for that Roy Evans investigation. It's a reactive, it collects what's typed, what's pictured and sent, right? TeenSafe keeps it and collects it. I don't know for how long do they store it, and I don't know how you as a parent often you can retrieve it. That's another option. You look into TeenSafe, okay? TeenSafe.org or something. If you're a PTA member, you can't PTA here. If you show them a PTA card, they give you a couple dollars off a month. I think it's like $8.99 a month, something like that. But let me tell you, with that Roy Evans case, the stepmom found all the stuff on Kik, and you know, it's her stepdaughter. The stepmom was awesome. She really was, but she did the worst thing you could possibly do. She saw it, she's shocked by it. I mean, it's her 14-year-old having sex with a 31-year-old man. It's, oh my gosh, right? Delete, delete, delete. It's the worst thing you can do. So, oh, I have TeenSafe. She told us like a week later, huh? So we called up TeenSafe, and they're like, here's everything. And they probably had 80% they had. Wow, it's a treasure chest. And they just gave it to us. And we didn't have to search for it.
What's a good alternative to Snapchat? Because I'm pretty sure that most of our kids use it. We can't just say, okay, you can't have it. That's how they're all communicating with each other.
Yeah.
So what's a better tool for them to communicate that we can monitor?
It's not just that it's a communication. It's also because it's a lot of fun with all the different things going on in the world. Like if there's a Super Bowl, then they're going to have all these, I can't think.
Filters.
I couldn't think of the word. And it's really exciting. And also to follow the movie stars, like on the Oscars, they're looking at what they say. And you feel like you have a connection with these people. So it's not even just the communication.
I
know, I'm just explaining. it's a combination of being into what's going on in the world, as well as communicating.
Yeah. The bottom line to your answer is you don't. All right, so I mean, it's the biggest challenge. Texting is easier than Snapchat, okay? But kids are moving away from texting. There are limitations to texting. One thing you do with Storylines is you create your own Snapchat account, and you get added, and you follow all their storylines, right? So at least you got that.
I know what that means.
Right? So, they can post just things like, hey, this is how my day is, this is how my week is, and they'll include pictures, and then, you know, I saw so-and-so today, and it's usually pretty stupid.
It's like a diary chat with another person. It's like a diary? Yeah, it's like their own post. That's the thing, that's not coming on. I'm friends with my kids, so I can just look and I can click and I can see their story for the day. It's like Facebook and their friend, and they post something, you'll see it. But you can't see it to another person. Okay, gotcha. And that's going to be almost impossible. Okay. I skipped over Grindr because it's a hookup app.
Just be familiar, they're a hookup app out there. No child should have a hookup app, right? Right? Okay.
No, it's just something, Instagram, for example. I have my kids' Instagram on my phone. So they log in to their Instagram from my phone, so I can see everything going on over there. Same with their emails.
Mm-hmm.
I have their email accounts also on my phone, so I can see this. Mm-hmm. Snapchat is different, but... Some
things are the same. Yes.
You can have. It's not just you need their phone to go to their phone and mm-hmm. look at it. I have it in all the time.
Yeah, Snapchat's a big challenge because it does go poop.
Yeah.
Right. So Omegle, that was a place to meet strangers. The bottom line is this is a video chatting sort of platform, right? And it's probably not the first, but it was the first big one to just go out there and meet strangers on video, right? But within 2 minutes, I can find a man masturbating, right? Right there in video. So we want our kids seeing that. So but you can put words in there to like have interest. So I thought I found something safe. The first word I ever put on Omegle was piano, right? It took me 2 minutes to find a naked man playing a piano, right? So that you don't want them on Omegle. The other thing about Omegle, too, is it's completely anonymous. So, you know, your kid could be talking to the predator can be having your kid do all sorts of things, or they can just be talking, right? But the moment they hang up from each other, they'll never find each other again. It's just too random, right? They don't have screen names, you don't log in, you're just generated a random number that goes away when you log off. But what the predator will do is have you move over to Kick, of course, right? So there's nothing for me to search for on Omegle, there's nothing to retain, there's nothing to keep, right? So Omegle's almost as bad as Kick. Meetme.com is a fake Facebook. The bottom line is a lot of boys in Montgomery County like to post their naked pictures on Meetme. So if you have particularly a boy that's on Meetme, just there's no need for it. Kids really don't use it. They're out to meet strangers on Meetme. And I think the boys see it as like no different than whistling at a pretty girl and like thinking in their brain, the pretty girl, ooh, she's going to come over to me, right? Never works, okay? This is the modern, hey, I want to put my stuff out there on the end, and the girl's going to come to me, right? Doesn't work, but they still have their stuff out there for all time and eternity. So that's why I have you look at Meetme. Scout, the blue target sign, you see that on, it's a hookup app. Okay, just be aware of that. It's geo-based, like all hookup apps. So they can find out where you are based upon your phone's location, so the predators can really zero in on you. You know, same thing with Tinder and Grindr. So it's dangerous. I'm going to skip over Whisper. Musical.ly, I want to show you a news story right when we're done. But basically, that is where all the little girls are going in particular. Boys are going there too. And because the kids are going there, the bad guys are going to go there. You can live stream. You can post videos. And it's like a karaoke sort of thing, right? It's really cute. It's really neat. But you have 60 million users already within like a year, right? And it's where the bad guys are going. But you can kind of interact if you go live. It's really frightening. Like I said, there's a news story that shows you how frightening it is. Because Musical.ly and all these places don't want you if you're under 13. But for some reason, parents, more than any of them, are letting their little 7-8-year-old kids on Musical.ly saying, it's fine, right? And I hear all the time, well, I created the account under my name, so it's okay. Yeah, but it's still your kid, right? So I don't see why that makes you any safer because you're the one that created the account.
If you lock it,
is it safe? What?
I just went on to Omegle.ly and just randomly, first thing I said, hi, female here from Arkansas, I'm bored, kick me at this address, I also have pictures that I can send. Bang, done.
Oh my gosh.
First thing.
Wow.
Is it possible on the settings on Facebook to make it private?
Yeah, you can lock it down, right? You can, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's better. It's a lot better, right? What you'll have to do research on is if people can share it. I don't know that. Okay? So
what do you mean you can't?
You can't make it disappear?
Right, Musical.ly. They won't, if you cancel your account, they won't delete it. They'll just keep it forever. Right, your information will be there forever on their thing. They just, you won't have access to it, you're done. But they keep it for whatever reason. The only exception is if you call and tell them or email them and say, yeah, my kid made it by accident, they're under 13, and then they'll make it go poof. Because like I said, none of these places want your child under 13. They don't want them. But yeah, music. And I threw that in there because I found it odd. I don't know why they do it, because it takes up space, right? And space is money. You know, Snapchat, everything goes poof, you know, gone. They don't want your stuff. Because that's more space and more space every day. So I don't know why Musical.ly's doing it. Maybe just to build up, you know, profiles and get big, and then at some point they'll get rid of it because they'll be big enough. I don't know. Real quick, here's some myths. Read them while I change the slide. These are absolutely myths, but, you know, like all myths, there can be exceptions to the rule.
Why is it a myth that they're pedophiles, if they're a predator?
All right, pedophile is a medical term. It means a sexual interest over 6 months, and there's a whole bunch of like pages written on it, but long and short, a prepubescent children, think 11 and under, okay? Most predators want that, what I said earlier, 12 roughly to 15, okay, 11 to 15.
And that's the same for boys and girls?
Yeah. Well, generally, yes. Boys tend to have younger boy victims, more younger boy victims than younger girl victims, does that make sense? But generally, yes. And the label for that is hepophile, okay? So, but we don't use these medical terms in my world. So, mostly men are 26 and older. Remember, Evans was 31. He didn't lie about his age. He told that 14-year-old he was 31. Okay. And usually don't abduct. Hey, how many stranger kidnappings? Jumping out of the bushes, you don't know who they are. Grab your kid. Stranger kidnappings occur in the country. How many do you think? Annually.
Very few.
Right, 120. There's 3,044 roughly jurisdictions, counties, cities, Indian reservations, that kind of stuff, right? So, very, very low probability, extremely highest impact crime, right? So they generally don't kidnap, but there's this new area of research that's being done and trying to create this new label. The best term I've heard, I hope it sticks, is called soft kidnapping. It's that one where the bad guy meets the child on the internet and grooms the child, and it's like, I'm gonna come pick you up, drives to the house, and the boy or girl leaves the house, walks and gets in the car, and they drive away. Right? That's technically, at that moment, not a kidnapping. And it doesn't get captured as a kidnapping. Right? Is it a kidnapping? I would argue, yes, it is. Right? And quite often, they turn into kidnappings when that child says, I want to go. And they say, no, no, you can't. Right? So they're doing research on that. I would venture to say you're going to hit 10,000 or more a year on that.
Ken, I recall also from your last presentation that I remember you focusing on the idea of the people who they know being most common.
Well, okay, so I made that comment. I do know what you're talking about. If your child is in, you know, heaven forbid, to be sexually assaulted, the likelihood that it's somebody that you know, let alone they know, is much higher than the stranger they meet even on the internet.
Sure.
It's the coach, it's the teacher, it's the uncle, it's the babysitter, it's, you know, right? It's somebody. It's the step sibling, it's the actual sibling, it's the stepfather, it's the actual father. You get my point. Right, overwhelmingly, you know, just like most murders are by somebody you know. Same thing, but more and more and more and more. And if I have the time to show the second news, they talk about Homeland Security made 2,600 arrests of these online predators. Most of them take time to groom, and the child gets to know them. Maybe not the real them, the fake them, but they get to kind of know them. Right, so that's that gray area that's growing more and more every year. 2,600, though, from Homeland Security is just a drop in the bucket compared to all the state and local people that make arrests every year. So just think, 2,600 is a drop in the bucket. I don't know, we probably make a total of 15,000 arrests of these guys every year. Do I have time to go over this real quick? And why I want to go over this is sexting. Okay, so I talked about the worst stuff, right, that could lead to your child becoming a sexual victim. It's terrible, right? But again, let's think about it. Low probability, lower probability, right? Contact offense, okay? Maybe up here for sending inappropriate images to somebody that's asking for it, and it's kind of growing every year, and so we got to monitor and stop that. And they stay victimized for the rest of their lives because those images are traded for all time and eternity, okay? But
what happens more and more than any of this is the kids sending sexting pictures back and forth, right? So what is child pornography? What isn't child pornography? And why in most sexting investigations do I have to tell the parents, sorry, there's nothing I can do? Give me 3 minutes to explain it. Child pornography is, for possession, the one of the people in the image or video has to be under 16, okay, to possess it, to own it, to have it, okay? So in Maryland, Maryland says it's okay to have a video of two 16-year-olds going at it sexually, and they say it's fine, you can possess it. Maryland says okay. You cannot film it, and you cannot trade it until they're 18, okay? So if I possess the two 16-year-olds, I can't give it to any of you, I can't sell it, and I certainly can't film it to make the video, okay? You understand the difference, okay? The age of consent in Maryland is 16, and maybe that has something to do with it. The age of consent in Maryland is 16 unless it's 14. Maryland says your 14-year-old can have sex legally as long as the other person, boy or girl, doesn't matter, is no more than 4 years older. So think about your eighth grader. Maryland says can have sex with potentially a college freshman if the 4 years is within there, okay? Think about that. So nudity. Let me tell you what child pornography is real quick. You have to meet some elements. You have to be engaged in a sex act under a certain age, which includes masturbating. You have to be excited. For boys, that's obvious. And for girls, that's interpreted by the courts as touching an intimate area. Okay? And or the BDSM stuff. Okay? I won't get too much into that. We don't see too much of that. So that is child pornography. So in Maryland, okay, in Maryland, I'm going to get graphic here, I'm sorry, but it's to kind of maybe stir something into some of you, parents who write Annapolis and get the law changed. In Maryland, you can have, let's just say, an 8-year-old child, boy or girl, doesn't matter, totally naked, laying on the bed on their back, spread eagle, holding their ankles, and it's not a crime. You can trade that picture all day long, okay? It's sick. Now, there are some exceptions to, like, as a parent, you can't be the parent taking the picture, okay? Because we have child abuse laws that would then come into play. But it's not child pornography, okay? It'd be child abuse. Boy, let's say another friend down the street takes a picture. The adult neighbor next door takes the picture, right? There's not a care and custody issue. Think about that. So what the feds have is another element that Maryland doesn't have. It's called focal point of the picture. What's the focal point? And that picture I just described, what would the focal point be? Your eyes would kind of go right to the private areas. It's just natural. And I know we're all not perverts, okay? I get that, but you would just go like, holy mackerel, right? That would be a crime federally. And that's what I would love Annapolis to do, is to get Maryland to catch up with the feds and let us get these bad guys that otherwise it's just labeled either nudity or child erotica, neither of which are crimes. So most sexting is nudity, the selfies, right? So you have the teenager or whoever standing in the mirror going, hey, geez, with their phone, fully nude, just standing there. Those aren't criminal, okay? So those get sent back and forth amongst the schools, right? And we get there and say, I'm sorry, there's nothing we can do. It's not a crime. So, not a crime to take the picture, not a crime to send the picture, not a crime to trade the picture, not a crime to possess the picture. It's just nudity as far as Maryland's concerned. What we do though, if it's a school environment, is we get all the kids that could possibly have the picture together. And we sit them down and we say, let's see your phones, let's delete, delete, delete. Our main goal is to mitigate the spread. Our main goal is child first. Let's protect this child who made a stupid mistake in sending the picture, and let's delete, delete, delete. We'll notify the parents what we've done. We're not worried about searching and Fourth Amendment issues and anything like that because, one, our main concern is to help a kid, and secondly, we're not doing a criminal investigation. But we are going to take the phone, we're going to delete, 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 and then we'll get the phone back. Okay? Everybody understand that one? Okay. Other times that we won't prosecute or arrest, even though it is potentially a crime, and it's not really our choice, it's the state's attorney's choice. A boy and a girl, they make a sex video, they're underage. 9 times out of 10, it's the boy that retains the video. He has it now, okay? And then he'll give it to his friends, and now you have distribution, right? And then the girl gets embarrassed, she's mad, rightfully so. She makes a mistake, we come and investigate. Guess what? The girl was the felon in the production of the video in the first place, and our state won't put the girl on the stand to testify that yes, that's her in the video, and that's the video that's spreading around, because she'll have to swear in her oath that she's a felon. They won't give her immunity. So we gotta say, sorry, there's nothing we can do. The state, meaning the prosecutor's office at this point is unwilling to give immunity for cases like that. Talk
to your children, right? Talk to them about reviewing too much.
So I'm sorry, why is she with Dolly?
Because she was a willing participant in the production of child pornography.
But I thought you said that if it was just them, it was okay to have it.
To possess it.
To possess it.
They filmed it.
They filmed it.
Yeah. You understand the difference?
No.
They created.
Right, so then what's the, what, and she's not a felon then?
No, you cannot manufacture or distribute it until they're 18 years old. So if they set up their camera on a tripod and make a sex video, you're producing it, you're manufacturing it.
So both of them would be felons?
The, both of them would be felons, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Equal felons, mm-hmm. Right? He no more worse than she at that moment, okay? So I think we, whenever we said, these are just some stats. Maryland does not have a specific sexting law. So, as a matter of fact, a couple years ago, they took this law out of my ability to use. If you send a lewd, lascivious, or obscene material, that law's gone. So, it used to be the sexting law. Maryland got rid of it. Okay. Real quick, cyberbullying. I know I'm past my 15, I really do apologize. All right, gossip. We all know what gossip is, not a crime. Right? That's bad. Exclusion, we talked about that. You know, not including people is not a crime. Impersonation, basically you hack into somewhere, somebody leaves their email open and you pretend you're that person and you send a nasty email to somebody else, right? Under that person, not a crime. Harassment can be a crime. The repeated posting or sending of offensive, it can be a crime. Cyber stalking certainly can be a crime. The key word there is intimidating messages, right? You meant to scare. I just think stalking. Flaming, typically not a crime. It's when you go, hey, Johnny, so-and-so said you're ugly. Hey, Bobby, Johnny said, you know, whatever. And you try to start a fight, right? Not a crime. Outing and trickery, basically telling secrets. Not a crime.
Basically middle school.
Yeah.
And cyber, sadly.
Cyber threats, you know, threatening or implying violent behavior. Can be a crime. I mean, kind of like all things on law kind of depends. But you see, most of the things, like you said, middle school, most of the things really aren't going to be a police matter. So we'll have the schools handle it, or we'll have the community handle it. All these kids right here are—they killed themselves over cyberbullying, though. So obviously, it's a big deal, right? And you hear about it more and more every year. The girl on the right, Amanda Todd, has a video. I encourage everybody here to watch it. It's on YouTube. It's not gruesome. Probably somebody here has seen it. I'm going to show like 2 seconds of it here. This is it. That's really her. Alright, so that video goes on for like 9 minutes or something. She tells her story, right? And you think you'd be bored. It's really compelling. Right? You're like, wow. Shortly after she made this video, she killed herself. Right? I think it was her third attempt and this one was successful. Really sad story. It's really telling though. So watch it. It's on YouTube. Okay, what they're teaching at schools and what we're trying to do is in law enforcement is like, you're gonna have the bully, you're gonna have the victim, right? This is where most people stand, right? They're the bystander, right? So we want to teach our kids, don't be a bystander, you know, be a defender. Go report it, go stop it. Don't ooh and ah, don't laugh, don't participate, right? Don't just watch and turn your head. Do something about it, don't be a bystander. So kids are gonna come home and talk about that. So just be aware of it. And certainly put the bug in their ear, don't be a bystander, right? Yeah, don't delete. That goes for all internet stuff. Don't delete, please. There are my 8 rules. This is where it ends, but I do want to show that 2-minute news story, if I can pull it up. These are our 8 rules. Everybody in my office who has kids, we have these 8 rules, okay? So you, meaning the parents, may look at it, meaning the contents, I'm talking cell phones here primarily, at all times, at any time, okay? You, meaning the parents, know and control all passwords, okay? Doesn't mean the kid doesn't know the password either. That's fine, but you know, okay? It's very important. 1 rule for the kid, never delete anything until given permission. That's the hardest one to kind of, you know, catch them at. What really works, I have to believe in this school, you have what I would call MomNet, where you kind of, like the moms, maybe some of the dads, like or can text or whatever, reach out. So the friends that hang out with each other, you know, if so-and-so comes home with
like a naked butt picture. Mom Ned starts firing off. It's like, hey, does your kid have the butt picture? Did your kid have the butt picture? Right? Mom Ned starts working. So then, you know, you check your kid's phone. It's like, where's the butt picture? Oh, I deleted it. Really? I mean, that's kind of one way to catch them, okay? But it's hard. Look at the dates, too, right? But that's a rule. Phone gets turned off at whatever time is appropriate for you. You're the parents, okay? I used to have a rule growing up. My friends dare not call me after 9 p.m., right? I would get in trouble if my friends would call me, right? I hated it. Phone charges overnight in the parents' room, obvious, okay? Control it. The door is never closed when the phone is in the room. I mean, think about the rule when PCs and laptops were new, you know, have them out in the kitchen, have them in the living room, someplace where somebody can always look over your shoulder and make sure you that checks and balance, right? Yeah, I mean, 1,000 more times powerful, you can reach out and talk to anybody in the world just with this. You know, you couldn't do that in first generation, third generation laptops. Yet we had the door open back then. Now we're letting our kids go and close the doors. It's ridiculous, don't do it. Phone never goes into the bathroom. Anybody know why?
Pictures?
That's where the big sexting mirror is, right? 80% of our sexting investigations are bathroom mirrors. Also, they drop them in the toilets and it costs you money. And this is kind of the catch-all, right? You lay out your expectations. Just Google internet or cell phone contract for children, right? Something like that. There's a bunch of them out there. Most of them are great. You know, they capture anything you want and literally print it up, have them go over it, read it, initial it, and keep it. But parents, you got to pull it out too and read it from time to time. Every 6 months, refresh your memory. Oh yeah, the phone is supposed to get turned off at 10 p.m. Oops, you know, I gotta start making sure we do that, right? So keep that in mind too. Hey, if you'll permit me, I got one video kind of shows the live streaming videos and what's going on with that. Okay.
Say hello to your new morning routine.
All right. Yeah, pay the bill, so there's a quick commercial. And it's a 2-minute video, and then I'll be available for
our snacks are not as exciting, but afterwards, we'll take a few minute break, and then we'll come over to the parent advisor questions, and there's some water and some chips and cookies up here, and some clementines over there to the side.
Well, if you're a parent, you probably know much, if anything, about them, but your children likely know all about them and are regular users of online streaming apps.
Yeah, and anyone can easily install one on a phone, and in a moment they can go live. But when young children go live, the question is, who's watching?
And 7 on Your Side troubleshooter Horace Holmes tonight with a warning to parents from law enforcement. And what you're about to see will leave you stunned.
The young girl in this video is not an adult.
Get the beverage you'd like from here at work.
And what you're watching did not come from an adult website. It was captured from the popular live streaming app, LiveRead. This and apps like it are wildly popular with kids as young as 7 or 8. But the apps themselves say they prohibit use by children. Kids love them because
they have my favorite songs on there.
Maybe even your kids. Just click on the app, get ready to perform, and then go live. Bryson is 13.
I broadcast and got a lot of views.
And that's the point of live streaming apps like Live Me and Musical.ly. Go live and get people to follow you.
Gymnasta, a lot of her friends just tumble around and have fun with it.
Though it's just fun for these girls, Homeland Security is worried others are being exploited.
Children are online, they're streaming with who they think are other children.
A lot of my friends have like 2,000 followers and things like that.
But that's ridiculous.
It's adults, and these adults are trying to prey on those children.
The Department of Homeland Security is sounding a warning, and so are 10-year-old Madison and her mom, who want their identities kept private.
They're like, can you bend over? Can you, like, do a backflip so, like, my shirt can go up and they can see?
Madison's mother was livid when she was alerted by an internet security watchdog group that saw Madison interacting on one of these streaming apps with a suspected predator.
There's little girls undressing, being preyed upon from predators all over the world. They remove clothing, they insert things into their body parts, Meanwhile, on the other side of the screen that they can't see is a pervert recording and selling it on the internet.
I didn't, know it was, bad or something, a trick.
And those images, according to law enforcement, often wind up in the child pornography trade. Homeland Security officers arrested more than 2,600 child predators last year, all operating in the shadows on these live streaming apps.
No clue whatsoever that it goes to this extreme, and I'm telling you, 99% of the parents don't know either.
If it's online, it's on the internet, someone's storing that, and it never goes away. So these children will be victimized for the rest of their lives.
I'm going to go use the bathroom, and then I'll come back naked.
Horace Holmes, ABC 7 News.
I'll be available for questions.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Bacheva, for contacting Science. If you want to go over and get a snack or ask a question, Dr. Sergeant Sanger, and then we'll go over some of the questions that were sent in to Alana Fine in 5 minutes. We'll go over some of those questions.